We already talked about how SpaceX's Starship can help us to build Moon and Mars bases, how it could serve as a troop transporter for the US Space Force, and how it could even help us to find alien life.
But how about if Starship could finally enable us to build Bespin? Could Starship really help us to build giant floating cities on Venus? Well, I'd say, let's find out.
Bespin, just one word, Bespin. We all love Bespin, the famous cloud city in Star Wars, which floats in the atmosphere of a gas giant, farming the valuable Tibana gas, run by the cool outlaw Lando Calrissian. Ah no, we mean the cool one, before Disney decided to transform Lando into an android-loving weirdo. So a cloud city. Let's be honest, who wouldn't love the idea of a cloud city on Venus? But what if the concept of a cloud city on Venus is actually not so far-fetched? Well, turns out that our often neglected sister planet Venus would offer the perfect environment to establish cloud cities. Venus doesn't get a lot of credit, because we all know that Mars is mainly in the spotlight. Mars just keeps stealing the show. But Venus is actually amazingly Earth-like in many regards. It's almost as big as Earth, with a diameter of 12,104 kilometers. It has 94.8% the size of Earth. Venus also has a very similar density to Earth. Consequently, the gravity on Venus is a comfortable 90.4% of Earth's gravity. So on Venus, you would not face the potential health problems associated with a low gravity environment, such as probably on the Moon and on Mars. Even though not 100% proven yet, there are strong indications that these low gravity environments would have detrimental effects onto the human body, such as bone and muscle loss, higher risk of heart disease, immune system weakness, and many more.
With 90.4% of Earth gravity, this would be not the case on Venus. There's only one slight problem though, you know, a very minor, really almost insignificant problem. Namely that the surface of Venus is a scorching hellscape. With a median surface temperature of 460 degrees Celsius, an atmospheric pressure of 90 bar, so 90 times Earth atmospheric pressure at sea level, which would correspond to a pressure as experienced 900 meters below the sea, and rain of sulfuric acid, this place is probably the most inhospitable and life-hating place in the solar system. So establishing a base on the surface of Venus will probably remain a very distant and far-off sci-fi dream for a very long time. Except of course in Wolfenstein 2, where the Nazis have established a base on Venus in a parallel version of the 60s and Hitler lives there. But believe it or not, the higher atmosphere of Venus is actually really quite friendly. This here is the temperature versus pressure for different heights above ground on Venus. As we can see, there is an area around 50 kilometers of altitude where the temperature and pressure are such as to be very similar to what we're used to on Earth. In this table here, we can see that at an altitude of 55 kilometers above Venus' ground, the temperature would be a nice and comfy 27 degrees Celsius. And for our American Fahrenheit-loving friends, this is 80.6 degrees Fahrenheit. And at that altitude, the atmospheric pressure would be a still acceptable 0.5314 bar. This is about the pressure at an altitude of around 5,000 meters above sea level. So about the height of the highest peak of the Alps.
This means that you would not need a spacesuit in this environment, only an oxygen mask. Because Venus's atmosphere consists almost entirely of CO2, it's therefore not breathable. But now imagine a cloud city on Venus, floating balloon cities, kept up by the buoyancy force. If you would step outside on such a cloud city, you would just need to wear an oxygen mask. Now sure, you should also wear some protective suit against the sulfuric acid cloud layers, because they will attack your skin. The cloud city itself should also have a protective layer against the sulfuric acid, of course. But in essence, you would have almost Earth pressure, Earth temperature, and Earth gravity at this altitude on Venus. Also, the thick atmosphere would protect you against cosmic and solar radiation to a large extent, because they would already interact with the even higher regions of Venus's atmosphere. So now you might be asking yourself, how does Starship come into play here? But before we answer that question, please consider to subscribe to us, because as a subscriber, you will get notified, so you can vote and decide on the next topic of the JS Space Report on our channel homepage.
So the answer on how Starship could actually help us to build not only giant bases on the Moon and on Mars, but also to build Bespin on Venus, complete with Lando and the Millennium Falcon hopefully, is really simple. Starship could fly to Mars by swinging around Venus. This has been recently proposed in a white paper by Noam R. Eisenberg from Johns Hopkins University and others, submitted for the Planetary Science and Astrobiology Decadal Survey 2023-2032. In this paper, Eisenberg suggests that a mission to Mars could be conducted via a Venus flyby. Now, this would offer some key advantages. The normal way missions to Mars are carried out these days, and how SpaceX and Elon intends to carry them out, is via the famous Hohmann Transfer orbit, where Earth and Mars align every 26 months. And the trajectory looks like this long elongated curve here. Normally, the travel time here is around 6 months. This also applies to Starship. There are, however, ideas floating around on how to reduce travel time down to 3 months. For example, the awesome idea of one of our amazing viewers, Boris Brodsky, who came up with the Star Kicker idea. In short, this would be a booster starship which would accelerate a passenger starship en route to Mars and give it an extra delta V, so more speed, so it would give it an extra velocity kick, so to speak. This might allow to reduce the travel time down to 3 months. We'll talk about this, however, in detail in an extra episode.
But a Venus flyby would have some major advantages. Such a flyby could be performed every 19 months instead of every 26 months. Then you would save a lot of fuel, because you would use the gravity of Venus to give the spacecraft an extra push for Mars. Then you could also return to Earth if something goes wrong on the trip, by slingshotting around Venus back to Earth, something you cannot do on an Earth-Mars Hohmann transfer orbit. And of course, the biggest advantage is you get a free planet. Starship would offer enough payload capability to bring payload for Mars and for Venus. For example, a few Mars habitats, and on every flyby, also a part of a Venus cloud city. After many flybys, you could construct your Venus cloud city on the go, so to speak. And Venus is not only interesting because we could easily build the aforementioned cloud cities, but Venus is also interesting science-wise, because turns out, this fascinating planet may have had oceans and might have been quite Earth-like for billions of years, maybe even up to until only 600 million years ago, as newer research indicates. So by studying Venus, we might learn more about the runaway greenhouse effect, which turned a potentially friendly planet into this hellscape. And since humanity is really trying its best to Venus form Terra, this could lead to some interesting insights on the climate dynamics of Earth.
Fascinatingly, the sulfuric acid droplets within the clouds aren't necessarily a showstopper to life. The Soviet-era Venera probes detected elongated particles in the lower cloud layer that are about a micrometer long, so the width of a small bacterium. These particles could be coated in ring-shaped polymers of 8 sulfur atoms called S8 molecules, which are known to exist in Venus's clouds and which are impervious to the corrosive effects of the sulfuric acid. Furthermore, S8 absorbs ultraviolet light, re-radiating it in visible wavelengths. If the particles are microbes, they could have coated themselves in S8, making them resistant to the corrosive effects of sulfuric acid. It has even been postulated that the S8 exists as a direct result of microbial activity. Unfortunately though, there seems to be no Tibana gas on Venus. Bummer.
So Bespin would need to find some other stuff to mine. And lastly, we shouldn't forget that Venus could also be a very fascinating prospect for terraforming. Since Venus farming terra might not end up so good for humanity, it might be a better idea to terraform Venus. And actually, Venus was the first planet proposed for terraforming by Carl Sagan already back in 1961, not Mars. A terraformed Venus would be truly a second Earth, so similar to Earth in size and gravity that this whole prospect is just too good to ignore.
Of course, this comes with some gigantic technological challenges, possibly even more challenging than terraforming Mars, about which we talked in detail in this video here and which turns out to be quite the insane challenge. But it seems that we might have to explore how to terraform Venus in another episode. So yes, the idea to fly with Starship not directly to Mars, but to do Venus flybys might be a really good one for all the above mentioned reasons. Except the one with Hitler, that one we won't be seeing fortunately. But the one with Lando and Bespin, hell yes, please! And talking about life in the atmosphere of Venus, if you want to know how Starship could help us to find aliens, even intelligent aliens, you can watch this video here.
So thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future! Please consider to subscribe to us, because we are the only futuristic space channel here on YouTube, which is insane enough to make jokes about secret Nazi bases on Venus.